Yeah,
hi Carsten.
Hi Bernard. Another day, another video, right?
Correct. So, you know, we have optimized the disk in the previous video, but now we want to talk a little bit about if the image or if the disk that we just, you know, created and optimized works, and also talk a little bit about the golden image creation, because you probably want your applications to be run in your desktops. And you don't want to install it on every desktop individually. So I think you will probably go for a golden image, and we'll try to simulate that. So Carsten, you're the master of ceremony. So I think you're going to create a sample or a golden image VM.
I will.
But okay.
So we are at step three in your how-to overview. And let's scroll down. Mm-hmm. We have nicely done some documentation here. So we first, for a golden image, we need a VHDX file with our operating system and some applications. We already have that downloaded from the Azure Marketplace, right? We optimized that image a bit in size in step two, and now we want to do something in the VHDX. For example, do Windows updates, because we downloaded a very recent one, but maybe there are more updates, and it's nice if you have a golden image to deploy from the newest update level. Then if you like the Azure resources are mostly in English, I assume, so maybe you have another language, and for us that would be German, for example. Install some things in there, and maybe some applications. So Bernard will tell you a bit about this process while I doing the work. So, but first let me start here. I have the Hyper-V manager. You see here, we have already prepared two virtual machines that we need later. Little bit of a shout out. This will be a storage spaces direct two node cluster for our user profile disk, but we will do that in a later video. Later. So I take another host.
Keep calm.
I'm very calm. So I have to create a virtual machine. Mm-hmm. And let's say it's, how would you say it? It's a golden image.
Golden image, or like, you know, give the operating system, maybe it's like a Win 11 golden image or something that you just know, you know, what it is or which operating system it is.
Ah, we do golden image.
Okay, Carsten is going to create probably a generation 2 virtual machine and place it on the cluster shared volume on his cluster node.
Yes, I will, but I take another pass. Mm-hmm. No, let's first do it here. It's a golden image. That's okay. So it's a generation 2. Yes. Mm-hmm. We will do something in the machine. So we give it some memory.
Yeah. 2 gigs.
We have to connect it.
Right, we will download maybe some stuff from the internet, like the updates. So therefore, it would be good if it's connected. And we are not attaching a new disk. We are attaching a clone of the existing one. So
yeah, we have already one. So I have to copy it.
Yes, right? Make a copy. Don't take the only one that we have. So
that's so true. That is so true. We have it in images, and it was this one. It's a multi-op.
I think, was it the, you renamed it. So, yes.
Yesterday, the 1st of August.
Sorry.
Yes.
Yeah, all good.
This was the name in your script, by the way. My name, okay?
Apologies.
Okay. So now we have a little bit of a problem. I haven't have the directories yet. So I will do an attach of the virtual disk later so that the directory structure is generated for me.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And now you see we have here there is our golden image. Mm-hmm. And the correct path would be a subdirectory with the name virtual hard.
I think you have disks. A typo here.
Yes, I have.
But
virtual hard disks, right? It's not right. Where's the name again? Virtual. Okay. Hard disk. But yeah, we can also peek in another machine, for example.
No, take it. It's all good.
It's okay.
I mean, it doesn't. As long as you know where it is.
Yeah, but you know, I like to be correct. So now I have lost in the copy paste buffer the image. I have to do it again because I copied the name. Mm-hmm. Copy, collect, Hyper-V, golden image, disk, and put it in here.
Okay, all good. Okay, so next thing would be to attach the disk and then make sure that it's booting from the disk. I think you also like to, you know, the automatic stop action might be, that's my thing that I usually do if I create new.
Yeah, I do that too. Good to mention it.
Okay. So wait. Yeah, it's just one disk, so we probably have that space on the drive. But anyways, so
there is a disk. Mm-hmm. Can do an inspect here. Yeah, it's our maximum size. It's mm-hmm. compressed. Nice. So the save action. Why is it important? I don't know if we mentioned that last time.
I think we did in the previous videos, probably when it came to the section of, you know, having a lot of virtual machines on your system, like, for example, when doing a VM fleet, and to have, you know, you may be surprised then how much space they need. If you have the save option, you need to reserve, you know, the amount of RAM it is. You know, for the save action, right? So the amount of RAM will be reserved on the cluster shared volume. And if you go to the limit, you may not have the space to. That's sometimes a little bit tricky, right? So in order to avoid that mechanism, not saving means shutdown.
Yeah, I had a customer who had a lot of Exchange servers.
You said that.
Yeah, with 100 gigabyte of memory for each Exchange server, and we were talking about over 100 Exchange servers. And they didn't know that, so they had to save action. And when you start a VM, it will reserve 100 gigabyte in the config file per VM.
Yeah.
And with more than 100 VMs, 100 times 100, we have 10 terabyte of space on your maybe expensive storage that is wasted, and you really don't need that. Yeah. Because in the cluster, if you shut down a node, the VM would be live migrated. We talked about that in the cluster settings. Only if you say don't live migrate when the node is shut down, then the save option should take place. So now we are here.
What we wanted to see, right? So I mean, we downloaded an image from Azure, we optimized it, and it's still bootable, which is good.
Yeah, it is. But now we have to do some things here. So I would assume we use a German keyboard here, huh?
Yeah, we do.
You maybe not if you watch from UK or Indonesia or wherever you choose your keyboard and your preferred app language, maybe. Yeah. So we go with German here. Mm. Our home country is also not the United States. Maybe we change that too.
Yep. So no, it's up, up.
So
up,
there are a lot of G's here.
Yeah.
All right. We go to next. We have the license terms we have to accept, and now we have to give the administrator password, and we take the same one that we had in the previous video series. Mm-hmm.
So Carsten has even changed the application language, but I don't think it will display directly in German.
No.
Don't be surprised. It's it may download the language pack. I'm not quite sure about that operating system. I'm not a client operating system man, by the way, so sorry for that. But there are processes out, you know, for getting the right language pack. I mean, you probably, if you're a client admin, then you know the process of downloading the language packs. It's also possible to script that. However, it's a little bit tricky in order to, you know, get all the languages for the applications as well. But you can do it. And that's maybe something that you would do in, you know, in a golden image, especially, I mean, it's depending on your users, but probably that's one thing, because we as Microsoft, we don't provide the Windows 11 multi-session image for other languages than English. We don't have the images.
Right? I have the same excuse than Bernard. I'm also not a client guy, and there will be better processes out there. So don't take what we show you here as the golden way.
Yeah, you can do me a favor and hit the Windows R or do a execute a winver on this one to show the operating system version. So if you hit the exit,
Windows R is not working. I need a shell for that. So I would go with, oh, this is the wrong window. I go here, right click, and I take terminal.
Yeah.
And then we can do winver you wanted, right?
Yes, and you should see the Windows 11 Enterprise multi-session operating system in the text.
Here it is. Yeah, right. It's tiny, but it's here. Yeah.
Yeah. This is what we want to see, right? So this is the thing that's only allowed to run either in Azure in AVD or on HCI with AVD, right? So these are the only two options at the moment when we took that video. To be allowed to use that operating system. Okay.
Exactly.
Don't use it on your physical desktop, right? No, not good.
So we go to updates. We wanted to update our machine, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Let's see if we do have
check
some
for updates.
I mean, we took a rather late or the latest build, right? So chances are that
from
there
July,
are
not, so yeah. There shouldn't be much. Mm-hmm. Maybe some Defender updates. Mm-hmm. I don't think there is a cumulative update out yet in August. Mm-hmm. We have not a second Tuesday of the month yet. Mm-hmm. It's actually the first Wednesday of the month, I guess. Mm-hmm. I gave the machine network connections. I configured the correct VLAN. We use VLAN tags here, so it can connect to the internet. It has a DHCP address, and here you see there is something there.
Okay, so while it's downloading and updating, maybe let's talk a little bit about, you know, what people would do with a golden image, right? So, I mean, you could install applications in there, but we need to do a sysprep after it, right? So if your application is not supposed to survive or work after a sysprep, don't do it, right? I mean, make sure that your application is, you know, surviving a sysprep. A sysprep is used for generalizing that operating system so that you can do multiple clones of it. And sometimes not every application supports it, right? Mm. Even if you are installing a lot of apps from the Windows Store, you know, some of them are sort of personal apps, so they land in the personal store. And these ones are most of the times conflicting if you do a generalize, right? Because a personal installed app is not a general available app, right? So that could be, you know, that's an area of conflict. I mean, there is tons of content out in the internet regarding sysprep issues. So, you know, start small. And there's, which means you may have to iterate through and test it. Yeah, so it's, you know, it's the image providing dilemma, right? So, I mean, you can put things in the image and then you'd only do it once in the image and then you clone it. Or if that's not possible, you need to, you know, use usual software distribution mechanisms like Config Manager, for example, in order to get your version, your application onto the onto the machine after it has been installed, right? And you may have to update it. So different approaches, still valid, right? You have to figure out, you know, either way, what works better for you in terms from a pragmatic, from a time-consuming thing, right? There is one thing that could help you in, you know, in doing the iterative approach, like checking if the sysprep works, and then if not, go back to a previous state, which is snapshotting, right? I mean, you have the Hyper-V feature for taking a snapshot of your virtual machine at a state in time, and then come back to this specific state. For example, you know, if you figured out that the stuff that you just did is not good and you want to revert back. So Hyper-V, you know, even with HCI, still does support taking snapshots. And I, you know, I'm not using snapshots regularly for production systems, but, you know, for images, I'll do. And that's, you know, just one thing to mention here if you're new to Hyper-V. There's another thing I'd like to mention, which is I have put you a link in the private chat window. If you could open it, it's not an official Microsoft, or it is. I just recognize, so even better. So if you can click on the link in the private chat and open it.
Yeah, but we need it here, right?
You want to show it? We want to show it to the people. Which is, you know, talking about optimizing these desktops. And there is a tool out there that could help you with optimizing this desktop in order to get shorter logon times, because you may have things in that operating system that not everybody needs. Some folks out there, you know, did write a tool which does that optimization work. They have counted some numbers of performance gains, you know, how faster you can log on, or how many more users you can host on that stuff, with or, you know, without the tool or after running the tool. So it might be worth having a look there in order to, you know, squeeze most out of it. To be honest, I haven't played with it. But it might have some concepts that you should at least be aware of, that there is something that you could try out if you want to optimize it, right? It's talking about disabling stuff that's not needed. It's talking about removing stuff that's not needed. Feel free to go there and have a look. Okay.
Looks very nice, but as always, there is more to it than just running.
Right? Yeah.
You saw here important information before running the tool.
Yeah.
Read through that, and there are JSON files if you want to.
Yeah.
That's nice. It's looking easy.
Yeah.
You see here. And, yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
I like it already.
Yeah, it depends on how deep you want to go, right? But at least we mentioned it, and that's, I think, part of that process. There is another thing, you know, if it would be Azure Virtual Desktop in Azure, you would have something, you know, like the Azure Image Builder, which is sort of, or the Compute Gallery, I think it was renamed, which gives you the opportunity to automate the creation and the storing of images, right? And I think you can even customize it with your own scripts. So for example, you could script to trigger off the update process, and then have a fresh updated system parked aside. However, the only caveat to this, it's an image then in Azure, right? So you would either need to download it like we did before, or you would, you know, sort of try to simulate the same stuff on premise. There are also tools for doing updates or image management on Hyper-V. For example, Packer from HashiCorp. You may know HashiCorp from Terraform. They also do that kind of stuff, not only for Hyper-V, but for a lot of other platforms as well. So if you want to look for the automated way of image creation and maintenance, you can do that, or have a look there.
But you don't have to do that. This is, of course, if you deploy a lot of VMs, have a lot of users, there will be a time where automation is the better way instead of doing all the processes manually. But if you deploy, like we do here, 2-4 virtual machines where you can host maybe 10, 20 users in it, you can do it manually. Yeah. But there is a lot of stuff you can do to automate that, right, Bernard? You don't let our viewers shy away. We have to do automation and everything, and maybe even PowerShell.
We don't show PowerShell here at that session, right? So this is this is all manual. You can update your image yourself, and I think we don't wait and keep on talking until this one is installed. So I think we'll flip or fast forward the video for
forward to the finished installation of the cumulative update. I was assuming the Microsoft image had it already in it, but it wasn't.
Okay, Carsten. Hey, the update was successful, right?
Yes, it took ages, I would say 20-25 minutes, and I was unsure because it was halting at 25% forever, so I closed the update window and opened it again. This is why we don't have the other three updates stated here. Okay. And Bernard and I, we discussed a bit in the meantime, and we want to try to install Notepad++ into this.
But so before we do that, I think we should give it a restart, because sometimes these major updates, perform some actions while the user is logged off. Yeah. So maybe
we do
also
that, maybe we should do a checkpoint, or should we do that after the restart?
After the restart, I would say.
Okay, then let's do the restart. While that, we can go to the Hyper-V manager. Mm-hmm. And in the failover cluster manager, I think you don't have the possibility to do a checkpoint. So you can do it in Hyper-V manager, you can do it in PowerShell, and you can do it in Windows Admin Center, I guess. So here is our machine, and here's a checkpoint part. You see we don't have a checkpoint. I go exit. It doesn't want me to reconnect. Yeah, this will maybe not work because it's installing the update. So don't use the extended session mode. Just use the not extended one. And there is our console doing the update. So going back to the checkpoint.
I was just smiling, but because I was, thinking the same way that you were thinking. Yeah. But anyways.
So for checkpoints, we have two different kind of checkpoints. We can do a production checkpoint, and we can do a standard checkpoint. And a standard checkpoint, if we have a running machine, would save the memory, would save the processor state, and then we can. If we apply the checkpoint, we can start where the machine was running. So it will be the next processor command. A production checkpoint is like a backup. Don't use it as a backup, but it will introduce a VSS, like a VSS snapshot into the machine. The machine knows I will be backup soon. So I care about everything that had to be consistent. And then we do a snapshot. And if we apply a snapshot, the machine is shut down. Yeah. So it's depending.
It feels like if you would reapply a virtual machine's snapshot, what was it? A production checkpoint.
The production checkpoint, exactly.
Then it would feel like if you come back to that one, it would feel like the virtual machine was switched off with that.
Yeah, like a restore from a backup. Yeah. It's not running. If you apply a backup, you have to restart the machine. So if you go here to the virtual machine, it's in the setting of the virtual machine, which kind of snapshot it does here under checkpoints. This is a default production checkpoint. And we will do that. I changed it because I was thinking if this machine will not going on with the patches and it hold at 25%, maybe I do a checkpoint, restart the machine and look if it's still working. But we don't have to do that, it finished. So here is a production checkpoint. And if it's up and running, we can do the production checkpoint. You see here, it's creating the checkpoint. And then if it's finished, we get a confirmation. And here we have our checkpoint. So now we can continue with the machine. And I switch to the enhanced session mode.
For copy and paste functionality.
Exactly,
Sometimes really useful. How you enable it. Watch series number one. It's a setting on each Hyper-V, and you can do it on the failover cluster or with Windows Admin Center for the whole cluster, I think. So now we decided, before doing the sysprep, we decided to install Notepad++ to try it out as an application. And the link is in the private chat window, Carsten. So if you take that one, it's rather easy. And Notepad++ is one of the tools you probably know, which is a good text editor or code editor.
And well, there was a happy users edition. I was tempted to use that one. But we go with the latest one.
Yep.
No. This is maybe... Why should I do this? Is here we go. It's an installer, right? We don't want the portable thing. We want the installer. Or we go with the installer. Come on.
Yeah.
So I have the installer twice. I open here. We see in the download. So we see it's 4 megabyte. That's not too much. So I go to copy. I go into my virtual machine. I start a file explorer. I don't want to drop it on the desktop. So let's do a temp directory that's not here. It is here. Come on. Oh, there's already some stuff from Microsoft in the temp directory. Wonderful. We have it here and now we run the installer, right, Bernard?
Yep.
Let's do it. So now we have the problem. Which language should we use? German?
I mean, it would be consistent to your what you were trying to do, right? Good next. Thing, yeah. Next. Here. Installation type. Drop down. Minimal.
Oh, minimalistic. Okay, we go with minimalistic.
Okay.
Shortcut on desktop. We do that.
Yeah, updates is sometimes, you know, you don't want to have the updates to be done from each individual user. You might want to do that on the image base. So sometimes you may want to, you know, check if deselect the updating functionality from the applications. But that's, you know, your decision here. Okay. So
now we do something else. We have to sysprep this image. Of course, if you want to install more applications, do that.
Correct.
But we will not. This is just our example application. We have also Office in there, so we have enough to show application-wise later. So now there is a very important sysprep, and Bernard told me that. And it is here in the documentation, right?
Correct. So the sysprep tool is for generalizing that operating system to make it able to, you know, to make clones out of it. And the sysprep tool is in System 32. You would call it with these parameters. So the first one is out of box experience, OOBE. The next one is generalize for, you know, for making this clonable. So it would remove the IDs that are specific for that installation and, you know, tell the operating system the next time you boot up, generate new IDs. Then you would do the shutdown option because you know you want to sort of don't do any changes after the thing, right? So you need to copy the data, the VHDX file, away from it. And then there is an important one, which is the mode VM, which tells the sysprep. I think it goes into the sort of drivers and the hardware setup thing, which tells the system or the sysprep, hey, you have been running on a hypervisor, right? Simulating the hardware X, right? And you're going to be running on a hypervisor. Yeah, you know, the clones that are made out of this sysprep stuff is going to run on the same hypervisor as well. So don't bother with, you know, the driver check or with the hardware, you know, reinitialization. Make sure that you're probably running on the same hardware as well or on the same hypervisor. And that speeds up, you know, the boot time from a cloned image dramatically, right? So sometimes if you omit this, you would end up, you know, creating a clone from that disk, from that sysprep stuff, from that virtual hard disk, and then wait for a long time for the hardware process to reinitialize. But, you know, with the mode VM, it should be much faster. Let's run it and see how that goes, right?
So it should shut down. Here is a sysprep. I didn't see it. So there it is. So it takes a while, and then it will shut down the machine. And then don't power it up again.
Yes. Because it would, you know, sort of personalize again, like a fresh installation. So this would be then the time to, you know, move away to extract the disk, to copy it aside, right? Yes. So usually, I mean, what you could do, and, you know, after, you know, usually a lot of people, especially the Windows guys, know this, you could work with unattend files. Right. In an unattend file, you could provide like an answer file, you know, to give the virtual machine the information that you would usually type in for language settings, time zone settings, name of the OS, for example, right? That can be customized, you know, with an unattend XML. This is what you could do after, you know, with that, or with that golden image, with that disk that you're just, you know, creating, or with that that we are just about to detach. Yeah, but that's let's just check if I
plus,
have a...
That's the plus plus part. We just wanted to do AVD and not how to do AVD.
Yeah, with an unattend
file. Through and optimize it and so on. There are a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Okay. Now our machine is shut down, is this prepped, and we can go on, I think, with our series, or?
No, I think you would need to export the disk because you made a snapshot out of it. And now look at the disk structure, what we have, and maybe we want to have it a little bit in a different way.
This one. Or do you want to go back to the snapshot anyway? Then we have to export it. You're right, to get one VHD and not a VHD with an AVD. We can look for it. Oh no, we had the path here, right? Here we are. Mm-hmm. You mean we have done a snapshot? So our original VHDX has a conserved checkpoint. It's not changed, and all the changes went to another file, right?
Correct.
So how do we proceed, Bernard? Should we delete the checkpoint, or should we export it?
So if you do a delete of the checkpoint, it would merge the one, it would merge into one file, right? I think you could, what I would do personally, I would keep, I would want to keep the checkpoint, but I would, you know, go for the disk and try to do a copy of it. And I think you have under Hyper-V, the disk settings, you can do the, you can do a copy of the disk. Right. So I believe if you go to edit disk on the right hand side, that's how I would do it. Right. Edit disk. Navigate to the difference in disk, please. Yes, select the one, do a next, choose action, do it like a copy or like a merge. Yes, please, because we want to merge it back to the parent. Next. Then do a new virtual hard disk. Now be sure to give it a name that we know to use one more time, right? So that would be our
I'm just thinking name where I placed it. Yeah, it was there. Mm-hmm. But should I put it here?
Yeah, you could do, but it would be like, you know, you had it in your collect folder for the images. There I would do it, right?
Because it's our new golden image.
Correct.
We can do that. Images. And then and let's say
custom or golden image, like, you know, like just
this
that we
need. Huh?
Yeah, that's okay. Okay. Huh? Sounds good. Okay, let's see if that works. It should be a little bit more than like the previous one. Oh, your system is fast.
Sometimes it is. Not with IOMeter, but this time it is.
Okay, let's see if we have it. There you go.
Here it is.
Contains the updates and the application. So I think
the 3 gigabyte larger, right? Notepad plus plus is very a big application and some patches.
I would assume this is
the other way around.
But anyways, okay. Now we have the golden image, and I think we are good for this video. So let's go to the next one, which is
let's do FS logic.
Okay.
Bye.